One of the most successful so far, and this is very controversial because all the industries will blame me and other company industries. One of the most successful so far in the IoT protocols is Bluetooth. Okay? And so we're going to talk about that first. And everything that you have, and Bluetooth is so common nowadays, and it's so much coming into the new devices that you're buying, everything that you're buying probably has a Bluetooth in it, related to IoT, right? So this is a very controversial statement because every company has their favorite protocol, and they're trying to sell that one. Bluetooth and Bluetooth Smart. Now, Bluetooth has two versions, Bluetooth and Bluetooth Smart. They are slightly different. And right now, Bluetooth is in version 4.2 to be exact. So if you buy something, if it is version 1.1, this is history. 1, 2, 3 are all history. 4.1, 4.2 is what is happening right now. It's moving by itself. Wireless personal area networks. We'll talk about wireless personal area networks. 802.15 is what we are getting into. And then we'll talk all about Bluetooth, packet format, energy management, how the protocol is stacked, how is it all different from Wi-Fi. And then we get into Bluetooth LE, which is the low energy. Again, this is different from Bluetooth. And then how they can stay on the same device. So the networks are actually classified by, as we saw in the previous picture, that you can have a 10 meter, you can have a 100 meters, you can have 1 mile, you can have 100 miles or 10 miles. So this is what we are talking about right now, is personal area network, 10 meters. Actually, they would say 100 meters or less, but 10 meters is all. Bluetooth only goes from here to there. If I go out of the door, it will not work. Or 10 meters. And so this is for body area networks. And then Wi-Fi is for bigger networks. And then we come into WiMAX and LTE for metropolitan area networks where we can be in, you know, a few miles. And then if you want to be in the suburbs, in the villages, then you need 2G, 3G, and these technologies. Okay? There are lots of competing technologies. Again, this is only one wireless course in so many weeks. So you can find lectures on my website for all of these, but I don't think we'll have time to get to them. From here, we will probably get into 2G, 3G, 4G, and 5G. That's where we want to get to. So the design challenges is the battery. First thing is the battery. And this is the battery which is shown here. So these are not cells like you use because you cannot afford to put the cells in a little device. These are very thin batteries, like the battery, watch batteries. And we want this to run coin cell. We want it to run for a few years. Okay? It's just like your watch. You don't change the battery on your watch every week, every month, or anything like that. You don't recharge it. I mean, it just stays there for a year. For a few years. And dynamic topologies. Second thing is things are moving, coming, going, sleeping. So the connections are very short term. No infrastructure, you cannot have an access point. And so generally, you know, they just have to do everything by themselves. Avoid interference due to larger powered LAN devices. Now they exist where the LANs are already transmitting. So one interesting thing is that here there is a Wi-Fi in this room where there are access points which are really powerful which are sending out these milliwatts. And there my little tiny little Bluetooth has to speak on the same frequency, 2.4 gigahertz. Same frequency, right? How can it work? So how to avoid interference into larger powered LAN devices? Simple and extreme interoperability. Now these devices are in a big number, so we cannot afford any interoperability issues. And you will see something different they do in this Bluetooth than they didn't do in Wi-Fi. is very strict in their availability. You can buy a headset from one company and you can buy a phone from a different company and they will work. You can buy a TV from a third company and they will work. You know, and so how does that happen? It's very strict interoperability. And of course, the cost is another one. You cannot sell this thing for more than $2. Okay, nowadays they're coming for free almost. I mean, like last week I bought a watch, I haven't had time to program it. It came almost free. All right, so I don't know how they make money on this, but somehow they will. And I have lots of other devices which are $2, $3, $4, $5. Remote control for these lights. You know, these are all internet connected. And things like that. $2, $5. Anyway. So, 802.15 group, which is sister group of 802.11, but meet separately. So, if I go to 802.11, 802.12, okay. So, they meet separately means they probably meet together because generally meetings are 802 meetings. And so, when I go to 802 group meeting, there is 11, 15, 3, everybody is there. So it's not that different. But 15.1 in 2005 did Bluetooth 1.2. And as we go into the history, Bluetooth came from outside, then into IEEE, and then right after this got out of IEEE. They just didn't like IEEE. So only 1.2 is IEEE. Everything else is a different organization called Bluetooth SIG. So the rest of it is not Bluetooth. And the rest of it is not IEEE. I mean, like, Bluetooth is not IEEE, right? So the blue, and then 15 then continued to work on things. And let's see, so the more important one is 2011, where they came up with the low rate personal area network, wireless personal area network. Low rate means 250 kilobits per second. And that led to Zigbee, which we'll talk about in one of these lectures. In between, people are trying to take it into every direction. So there are people who want to increase the distance. There are people who want to increase the rate. There are people who want to decrease this and increase that. So there are so many parameters. And there is a standard for every win, let me put it this way. So there are high rate 5, 55 megabits. The ultra wideband 5. There are gigabit 5. And then there are 250 kilobit 5. Okay, and of course, since they're all different, basically. So, I mean, like, learning about one doesn't tell you about the other. But I will just give you some flavor of some of these so you know how these work. And then 15E, 14.4E came out with some MAC enhancements to reduce the overhead. And then they talked about active RFID. So, RFID is an old technology. And every time you go to Walmart and come out, you pass through an RFID scanner, right? Everybody knows RFID scanners, right? And so that's an old technology. I wasn't going to talk about it, but then I think we will probably end up talking about it because that leads us to RFID takes us to what is called NFC. NFC. So if I want to go to NFC, then I will have to take RFID. Then smart grid networks, smart utility networks is in 4G. We will not talk about that actually. There's medical body area networks in 4G. Then critical infrastructure monitoring by very low energy. So this is critical infrastructure could be anything including the power transmission systems, but could be any other utility system, water systems or gas systems kind of. TV white spaces. Again, white spaces are being done both in 15 and 11. Okay, so white spaces usage in a smaller area and white spaces used in wider area. So there are different things. And what is white space? That's a good question, but I think I will hold on to that until we get to white spaces. And rest of it is standard, different varieties of things. The more important one is mesh networking. So there is a standard 802.15.5, which allows, which says how to do mesh networking, which means how to go from here to there through many devices. So you have one sensor, mesh sensor, another sensor, and then you get out of the building. So mesh networking, body area networking, another one which came out, the previous one was a little bit earlier. Medical body area network is here, J. Does it on the slide, there is a J? Right here, 4J. Body area network 2013. So they're happening at the same time, maybe different frequencies. Anyway, so this is body area networking, medical and entertainment 2012. Visible light communication, I found this interesting that now that there is no spectrum left, if you keep increasing the frequency, it becomes light. Right? So people are now doing the communication using light. And so that is happening. There is a 15.7 R1 is happening right now, which is optical wireless, infrared, and visible light. And then 15.8 is peer aware communication, which I didn't get into so far. And there are lots of things which are happening. So I don't know whether I want to get into those, but basically key things are which are underlined. And among those, actually, only some of them we will have time to talk about. So first is the light communication, wireless optical communication. Optical wireless or wireless optical communication or visual light communication. So basically, the idea here is that these lights can also be the access points. Light bulb can send information that my computer can easily decode. And you and I will not feel any difference because things are zeros and ones are coming at very fast speed. Our eyes can't see them, but they will be seen by the computer. So optical wireless using light, localized. The advantage of this is that nobody outside the room can see it. Right? So there is no problem of somebody, having a transmitter or receiver or snooping on us. Second thing is that we can use the same thing in this room. I could have 5 lights. 5 access points, and there won't be interference because each has a defined area. And it's particularly good if you have devices which are electromagnetic sensitive. Like if you're flying in a plane, it is much easier to give you gigabits through the light than through Wi-Fi. Because Wi-Fi can interfere, but the light will not. So this is our very beginning, Li-Fi. This is the very beginning. Okay? January 2015 presentation was done at IEEE, very first presentation. Yeah.
So why is it electromagnetic energy?
Why not?
Yeah, why is it electromagnetic?
Oh, so basically the light does not interfere, for example, it doesn't interfere in copper, right? So it doesn't really affect the copper signal at all. And it can only travel in open space. So if I put something here, it will not interfere. But wireless, on the other hand, can travel through many, much more materials. Right? So if I put something here, the wireless can find it, and wireless will interfere with that.
If you have two access points,
oh, no, no. So they will have to do something about multiple access.
Okay.
They will have to do multiple access. If you're talking to the same person, of course you have to have multiple access. And then we'll get back to whatever we do, zeros and ones. The thing is, yeah, right. So you're not going to interfere with unintentional people who are not really interested in this. They're doing their own thing, right? In fact, interesting thing is that these two guys could talk, and the genes could cross, which could not be done in wireless. Right? Yeah, go ahead. Right. It comes severely confusing. It comes in the electromagnetic spectrum, right? But it does not have the magnetic properties that the radio waves have. And this is beyond me, okay? I'm not going to take any further than that. So here I think sound is also, that way doesn't really interfere with the radio waves. So there is, at some point, things become different. So light has some different properties than radio waves. Okay. And what exactly is the difference? I don't know. I mean, maybe there's some physics question which I will have to figure out. At what point does it exactly becomes light? Because I mean, thing is continuous. We saw the whole spectrum. It has the same waveform. It has the same waveform. It has the same all the formulas that we learned about. In fact, the radio waves, we calculated the speed of light, right? So the speed of all the waves is same, whether it is light or radio or anything, right? And the question is, at what point they take this different property? I'm not sure. All right. Okay, I think I put this slide in the wrong place. Is it duplicate? I'm going backwards. Okay. Let's see. Going this way. Okay, so Li-Fi is one slide before this one. This is actually a deleted slide. This should not be there. Okay, so this is my rest of deleted. Now we come back to Bluetooth. Now the Bluetooth is named after the king Bluetooth. Actually his name was not Bluetooth, his name was Harald Blåtand, something like that. Okay, Danish king. And but he was fond of blueberries, so his tooth were blue. His teeth were blue. All right, and why it is named after a Danish king? Because this technology came from that country. Okay, so it originally started with Ericsson, and Ericsson's Bluetooth project in 1994. And what they wanted to do was they wanted to have cell phones talk to each other over short distances. Okay. And then Nokia and other companies joined and they formed a standard body called Bluetooth SIG in 1998. And in 1999, the standard came out. They went to IEEE and got the IEEE seal 15.1 in 2002. But they were not very happy with the time it takes in the standard body. Okay, and this is true. Because if you can have five or six companies can get together and they can easily make a standard, everybody agrees, no problem, right? When you go to 200 bodies or 2,000 people, there are a lot more divergent opinions and everything takes time. So they came out of IEEE and so the later versions are handled by the Bluetooth SIG. So 4.0 has nothing to do with IEEE, for example. So the key features are, very low power. Now this is why they're version 1.0. So these numbers have all changed. But very low power, 10 microampere in standby. So when nothing is happening, it is taking very little battery. 50 milliampere while transmitting. Now this would be considered, both would be considered very high for today, but it was 1994 and 1998. $5 per device. And 9 millimeter square single chips, 9 millimeter square. You can imagine 3 millimeter by 3 millimeter. You know, it's like less than your nail. That is how big. I mean, very small chips can handle the whole thing. So there have been lots of versions starting from 2002, 1, 5, completed 2003, number 2003. And higher variable rate transmission. So SCO is synchronous. Basically, so what happens is Bluetooth has a special mode for audio because phone companies are making it, their main application is audio. Right? So they have a special mode, SCO. So they change that. And then there is adaptive frequency hopping. So as we go into the details of Bluetooth, one thing you will find is that it uses frequency hopping. So we have talked about frequency hopping where you change the frequency every few milliseconds, and that is what is used in Bluetooth. Okay, you will see that. But they made it adaptive so that if there's interference, you go to different frequencies. 2.0 increased the data rate further, and they started getting 3 megabits using GPSK. So previously, they did tell you the rate, but it was more like 1 megabit, and used very simple modulation. Now they went into differential phase shifting. And then they start thinking about the video applications, and they, and so on and so forth. 2.1, again enhanced data rate. And then the secure pairing. In the beginning, the pairing was not very secure. Any device could connect to any device. And then they introduced some idea of putting zeros and numbers and IDs and so on and so forth. And now, I mean, like, basically now it is much more convenient and secure, but previously it was not. So they started thinking about secure pairing in 2007, moved on to 24 megabits using Wi-Fi assist. Wi-Fi assist means that you talk in Bluetooth and you tell the telephone, look, I'm going to send you this, and then you send it through Wi-Fi. So that's how they got 24 megabits. 4.0 is low energy. So this is basically IoT time frame. The smaller devices are requiring larger battery life several years. So they had to create a new file, which is totally incompatible with the previous one. And this is called Bluetooth Smart, or BLE. BLE is Bluetooth Low Energy. Right? So BLE or Bluetooth Smart. Then 4.1 came about, fixing to the same things, and then 4.2 has come about, which is larger packet, better privacy, and IPv6 compatibility. Yeah.
So the definition of smart
technology. Now this smart, actually, so Bluetooth is already, I mean, if you just say networking, Bluetooth is networking, right? So yeah, your point is clear that now when we talk about smartness, you're talking about the smartness for the Internet of Things, right? So when we say Zigbee is smart, Zigbee designed for Internet of Things. Bluetooth is smart, Bluetooth especially designed for Internet of Things. So that's a good observation that basically smartness, I said that the smartness is moving from computation to storage to communication. Now it is moving to communication at low energy. Because communication, there are many communication technologies, but we are trying the lowest energy we can do, and if something can do low energy, we call it a smart. All right, good. All right, so now we have 4.2. We will start with 1 and then move, just jump straight to 4, okay? We won't do anything in between. So 1. So 1 ran actually in 2.4 gigahertz band, so there's complete 80 megahertz, uses whole thing, 79 megahertz band. It is the whole frequency band. Remember, Wi-Fi divided this into 20 mega, they decided 20 megahertz to be used. These guys decided to use the whole 79 megahertz, and which is less in some other countries. But anyway, and they get 1 megabit at the file layer, but they get 720 kilobit at the user layer. Basically, file layer is where the zeros and ones are happening, but there's a lot of overhead, you know, headers and things like that. By the time it comes to the user, user gets 720 kilobit. And 1 megahertz means that while they're using the whole band, 79 megahertz, they're using it 1 megahertz at a time. So they just half. So they're using this 1 megahertz, and they're going to this megahertz, and they're going to that megahertz. So they're using only 1 megahertz, but they're using it all over. Hopping. So they get 1 megabit. And how often they hop? They hop every 625 microseconds. Okay? So 1600 times per second. Security. They use challenge response authentication and 128-bit encryption as a standard. The output power is 20 dBm per 100 meters. They have three classes of devices. Class 1, go up to 100 meters. Class 2 go medium and class 3 go 10 meter. They send 0 dBm or 1 milliwatt. Class 2 send 2.5 milliwatt or 4 dBm. And class 1 send out 20 dBm, which is 0.1 watt. Alright, so obviously class 1 devices probably are not powered by battery because they are giving out 0.1 watt on the air, but class 3 probably are. Okay, and this one shows the frequency hopping. So what I am showing here is two different networks in the same room or in the same space. So blue network was here at this frequency. This is frequency and this is time. In this slot, the blue network was here, then moved to that one and stayed here, and then moved to that one and came back, and then moved here, and then went there, and moved there. It is randomly hopping. Alright, so there is a random number generator, which both the receiver and the sender know. Actually, everybody knows the random number generator. Everybody knows. Only thing different is the seed. So the seed is different, the random, and the seed is known by the receiver and the transmitter. They know exactly that they are going to be moving to. Right? And so these are all random patterns. Similarly, the other network also is following the same random number generator with a different seed. And it's producing different set of random numbers and then it moves. Once in a while they might collide, but most of the time they are okay.
So, how do you
the transmitter in the speaker, like,
the different frequencies? Is it
like
one, the transmitter
comes to the receiver, the speed? Right, so then you connect. The thing is like this. When you connect, let's say I connect to you, at that time you negotiate all the parameters, and one of them is speed.
And then
they're connected forever. I mean, the thing is, when, say, randomly, you use Bluetooth for headset or something, like when it connects to your phone or when it connects to your TV, at that time all the negotiations are done.
I'm saying, is the pattern of it a function of the speed and the time? Or
okay, so you know how the random number generators work. Basically, random number generator is simply a formula. Okay, it could be a very simple formula such as x new is equal to 5 times x old plus 1. That's it, period. That's a very simple, and that's a random number generator. Okay. Not very practical, but it will generate random numbers between 0 and 4. Okay? So, you do use that formula, but the thing is, what is the X0? Right? Everybody using X0 will get a different sequence. And then you just put into the formula every slot and you get it, right? But there are certain rules that you can see that you don't move in certain slots here. So, that is, there's a rule here, because in the middle of the transmission, you don't move. Is that sending a packet, the whole packet goes at the same frequency.
And are the seeds designed such that they're not going to interfere or get to the same thing all at the same time?
Now, the seeds are actually not designed that way, but you could select, if you're smart enough, you could select, let's say, 10 seeds, which will generate numbers which are not going to interfere much. But I don't think people do that. Okay? I mean, in the simulation, we use random number generators in simulation analysis. When we do simulation, we need random numbers. And we use the same random number generators and we use the seeds. There, we select 10 seeds such that there is no overlap among the 10 streams. But here, there is not much coordination. Yeah.
So, to support the XXX.
Can you support what? Yeah, direct sequence spectrum. Okay, yeah, it's spread spectrum. So the spread spectrum comes in two ways. One is direct sequence, another is frequency hopping. This one is frequency hopping. If you remember, Wi-Fi did direct sequence and frequency hopping also, right? But we didn't talk about much about frequency hopping. It was not used much. You know, A, B, C, D, F, G. All of them went into FDM and then never came back. Right? So that was an element. Here they started with frequency hopping. So this is not DS. This is not direct sequence. They're not going to make 11 bit out of 1 bit, 11 bits out of 1 bit, nothing like that. But the key new thing that you are learning is, for the first time you are seeing the frequencies are happening and how often they are happening. See, the capturing few milliseconds, things like that, this is actually 625 microseconds. This is the real.
Why
do they do frequency hopping?
Because there is no any damage here, like...
Yeah, right. So the reason, I think when we talk about frequency hopping, then we discuss this thing. The frequency hopping was invented for military purposes so that nobody could jam. But soon they found it can be used for sharing. Why? Because if we use different fields, we could all talk at the same time on the same frequency, no problem. Right? So even though there is no jamming, is not the issue, but then there is no interference when we are sharing on the same frequency. Band, actually, not on the same frequency. On the same frequency band. So there are so many, now right now, I'm sure that half of the Bluetooth devices are on in this room, right? If there are 16, 17 people, there is eight Bluetooth going on right now. Other half may be off, otherwise everybody's Bluetooth is on, right? Right. So the thing is, I mean, I'm not sure. Okay, so that's the thing is that I am not sure how you decide this hopping frequency. Everything here is come from some analysis. There must be a paper which people did the analysis and said, if you have this happen, you know, what is the positive, what is the negative of happening much later and less. So here, with 625 microseconds per hop, you might get, when you get interference, the number of bits that are affected is small compared to if you had, you know, happening every second. Then you might lose 10 packets in a second. Here you lose part of the packet and maybe you make it up somehow to CRC or something. So hopping very slowly will not help much because then you are almost constant. And hopping too fast obviously has disadvantages because you have to reset some things in this circuitry. So they came up with 625 microseconds per hop, and as I said, they don't hop in the middle of a packet. So this hop is less than a packet. You see, the packet could be three slots, right? And so clearly they didn't want to hop much slower. If you hop slower, then your whole packet will be gone and you won't notice it. Now you probably, you know, will notice some packet, part of the packet. All right. So they form what they call a PicoNet. A PicoNet has a master. Now here another thing which has happened over the years. Previously all the networks used to have masters and slaves, but not in 2015. We don't talk about slaves anymore, so we call them primary and secondary. But this is not today. This is old technology. This age is showing. They have masters and slaves of that era. Okay, so there is a primary station or master station, and it is controlling these things. Now, when you are in a different scenario, yeah.
So,
are you
referring to the difference in terminology or technology?
Just terminology. Yeah, so I mean, previously, everything we talked about, HDLC had masters and slaves, Bluetooth had masters and slaves. So, many protocols, basically, when they need a coordinator, we call them master. And everybody else is slave. But nowadays we don't like to call that, right? We call them primary and secondary. So just the technology. Technology is still the same. SDLC has not changed. But if you write a book on SDLC today, you would say primary and secondary, and so on. If you develop a new protocol today, you will call them primary and secondary. Alright, so this is a primary, these are all secondary, and each primary can have up to 7 secondary active, and rest of them sleeping. So we call them PARG. So So you can have a network of 255 devices, one PicoNet, one network with one master and everybody else PAG. Now, PAG means not talking. Basically, they are sleeping. And generally, you never have this size networks. You always, generally, you have one and one. Generally, your phone is talking to the headset. Maybe that's it. Maybe you have watch talking to that one, number two. Maybe you have something else, number three. So very small networks. Okay? And in this scenario, which I just described, you can guess who would be the master. Your phone. So one of the nodes becomes a master. Again, this is not a special node or a special, this is just a function which is generally assumed by something which is more powerful. Okay? Yeah, question.
So when the headset connects to
the
two phones, the headset is
enough? Well, no, actually phone is generally, I'm just saying that the because the phone is the central point. Headset is just an accessory for the phone.
So one headset can connect to two phones
at the same time.
Exactly.
Yeah, that is the second consideration here. Okay, I'm coming to that part. Okay, so basically, just think of a normal, simple, the simplest case is only one master. Okay, but of course you can have two masters. That is more complicated. But let's just cover one master. So one master can have 7 active slaves, and I just want to emphasize the word active here, because you cannot have more than 7 active, while you can have 255 PAG slaves. So there could be slaves that joined the network and then went to sleep. Active slaves are pulled by the master for transmission. So the master keeps asking, do you have anything to send? And each system gets 8-bit PAG addresses. Now the numbers 255 and 7 come from how long the addresses can be. The 3 bits I can talk to 7 people, actually 8 people, but 0 is not an address. So 7 people I can talk to. With 8 bits I can talk to 255. Right? So even though you might have a global address of 128-bit or 48-bit or whatever, but when we are talking, when you come to the network, we give you a nickname. A short address, which is either 3-bit or 8-bit. Okay? And so we call you by your nickname, and that is 7 active. And then if the PAG one wants to come in, then they have to say, hey, I woke up, can I talk? Then it will take 2 milliseconds before they will be able to join. Whereas the active station is continuously talking and, you know, doing. But the sleeping people will sometimes wake up. And other stations can join even more times. So if somebody else wants to come, suppose I have 7 stations, suppose I have 4 stations and 5th wants to join, it will take longer because they have to do all the initial negotiation. Now then there is a concept of a scatter net, which is a device can participate in multiple PicoNets. So this device is talking to 2 PicoNets, here and here. Right, this is your headset talking to 2 phones. And I don't know that every headset can do that. You have to buy a special headset for 2 phones?
Yeah,
okay, multi-phone. Okay, yeah, all right. So then they support the speaker, which is called ScatterNet. And so basically what it does is half of the time it is serving that, another half of the time it is serving that, or, you know, then when it is serving this master, then it goes to sleep here. And, you know, comes back in 2 milliseconds, and you don't notice 2 milliseconds. Right? So, time share and synchronize to the master, the current PicoNet, and routing protocols are not defined. So, there is no routing protocol that you can go from here to there. It is just that this node can talk to 2 masters, that's all. That's the end. Okay? The mesh routing protocol is there, which comes later on, which is not part of this thing. Which is part of 11, 15 and so on and so forth. All right. So this paper, which you can download, is very easy to read and has a good introduction to Bluetooth. Please do that. Now, frequency hopping. A little bit more detail about frequency hopping. So these are the rules. We'll go slowly one by one. 625 microseconds using a 312.5 microsecond clock. So this clock is just half of that. 625 divided by 2, you get this number. So the clock increments every 312.5 microseconds. When the clock becomes 2, you know that time to half. And time division duplex. So basically, so this is only one frequency, right? But we do time division duplexing, like on the road when there is a construction, you know, we talked about that one side goes and then only one side is done and the other side does on the same road, walk on the same road, right? That is time division duplexing. Actually, in some sense there is half duplex, but that is what it is, time division duplexing. Downstream and upstream alternate. Now what is downstream? So basically talking to the master, master is up there. Talking to the master is upstream and master talking to you is downstream. Master starts in the even numbered slots. So if the slots are numbered and the master will start. So let's think that this is the master, the first one. Even the top line is for the master. And it starts in the even number. So numbers are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 0, 2, 4, 6. Those are all even numbers. And the master can start in that one. The slave can start in the odd number slot only. Okay? The slave can transmit in one slot right after receiving a packet from the master. So if the master sent you something, you can say, I got it. You don't have to get any permission from them to talk. Otherwise, you need a permission. Okay, but the only time you don't need the permission is when the master has sent you something, then you say, okay, I got it. Slaves can transmit in one slot right after receiving a packet from the master. And packet lengths are either one slot, three slot, or five slot. They're not very long packets. So this 625 microseconds is related to the packet sizes. The shortest packet is 625 microseconds, which is one slot. It could be three times that or five times that. You can't have anything in between. Or anything in all there. One, three, and five. And frequency hop is skipped during a packet. So when you're transmitting a packet, you just stay at that frequency, whatever you started in. Okay? So let's see here. This one started here and finished before this slide is over, no problem. This one started here. No problem, this one started there. This one continues because this packet is three halves. Three slots. Right? Two plus one, yeah. Yeah, no, no. See, this is, so basically, when we started here, the very first time, then both the transmitter and receiver know that the packet is coming. Right? And we know what frequencies are coming at. And we know what the length of the packet is, because the header will tell you, right? So now we know that for neither the transmitter nor the receiver will move. That's all.
How would you know that other station must come to you?
So everything is controlled by master. See, the thing is, when you have master slave protocols, what it means is that you cannot just start talking like this. You have to ask the master, right? I mean, I think master will tell you that, okay, so this is why there is polling. I talk about polling. So when there is nothing going on, the master is simply polling. Number one, do you want to talk? Number two, do you want to talk? Number three, you want to talk? Number four, you want to talk? Number five, you want to talk? Everybody says, no, all right, I'm going to talk, right? If number three says, yeah, I want to talk, then okay, then, you know, you go ahead, you know, you send it. Right? So master and slaves, they know who is going to speak then. Master, yeah. This is the case we talked about here. when you have multiple masters, they are virtually multiple masters, you really connect to one master only while you are sleeping on the other network. When you are sleeping on the other network, nobody can talk to you at that time. When even one phone call is over, then the next phone call will come. Right? So basically, you cannot be continuously switching between back and forth. It takes 2 milliseconds to switch. Right? I mean, to wake up, it takes 2 milliseconds. If you're sleeping on one network. So you cannot be talking to two masters at the same time. Okay? All right, the packet is very small, and it has a 72-bit access code, 54-bit header, and up to 2745-bit payload. If you add up everything, you will get 3125 bits, which is 5 slots. Okay? Now, this is interesting. 1 megabit per second, 625 bits per slot. 625. Yeah, right? So, this is basically 5 times that. Access code. What is an access code? Access code is the channel access code identifies the PicoNet. So, say I'm talking in the PicoNet number 3. Device access code for paging request and response. So this thing says, okay, when the master is saying number 3, that means number 3, do you want to say something? This packet is coming to number 3. And when the number 3 talks, it says, I am number 3. So that becomes the source address, becomes basically 3. Master is always understood. So device access code for paging request and response, and inquiry access code to discover unit. And so there is a discovery process in which the masters want to find the slaves and the slaves want to find the masters. So, you know, basically that is when they are trying to figure out if there is another Bluetooth device, right? You press the button on one and press the button on the other. That is the discovery phase. And in that there is some kind of code which is sent, which will basically say, in, you know, for example, from a device, a slave might say, is there a master here? And then the master might say, okay, so I am the master number 3, or I am the PicoNet number 5, or 3 actually, and does anybody wants to join? Right? So the access code is generally one of these three things. Either it identifies the PicoNet, it identifies the device, or it is the inquiry access code which says that I really don't care who you are, but I just want to get somebody. Right? Broadcasting nothing. Three things in that 72-bit thing. Header, the other one, 54-bit, that has 3-bit number address. 3-bit, that has 7. This because it says my favorite unit number 7, or unit number 4, this packet is for you. Okay? That goes in the header. Type code, what kind of packet it is, whether it is a data packet or control packet. Flow control, whether I flow control, which is to do with the, you know, whether generally in TCP, flow control means whether you can send it or stop or something like that, on off. ACK or NACK, 1-bit. Sequence number and header check, 8-bit. So in 8-bit, they have sequence number as well as the header error check. So I think the sequence number could be 2-bit because I cannot think of a HEC which is less than 6-bit. 6-bit error correction, header error check. And then 18-bit header is encoded using, so the total is 18 bits. This is 3, 4, and 1. 8 plus 8, 16. Look, I'm missing 2 bits. So, 3 plus 4, 7 plus 1, 8 plus 8. So, 2 bits I'm missing. So, maybe one of these is 2 bits. Anyway, so total is 18 bit header. And that is encoded using 1-3 rate coding, makes it 24, 54 bit. This is the same thing is transmitted 3 times. 18, 18, 18. So, 1/3. So basically, you get 54 bit out of 18 bits. Synchronous traffic has periodic reserved slots. Now, here, if you are talking audio, then audio is synchronous traffic. And so then you don't have to ask every time you want to say something, because we know that every certain amount of time you will have some packets to send, some bits to send. So you are reserved for that one. Other slots can be allocated for asynchronous traffic. So the master keeps track of all the slots and knows which are already given out. And then it asks people whether you want to talk and how long you want to talk, and it just tells you when to talk. Okay? So there is no contention as such. It is all by coordination. Let me see. Any question about this, Heather? Okay, then let's move on to the states. So every node can be in one of these 8 states. It could be standby, disconnected, not on. That is what most of the time, most of the devices have. Then they want to connect, they will send one of the two, either inquiry or page. Inquiry is trying to find somebody, and page is actually to locate somebody we already know. Okay? So it's a different kind of inquiry. But inquiry is, I want to find somebody. Is there a phone around here? So that is one of the states. And from there, we get to connected state. And once we get connected, we can transmit continuously. And once we don't want to transmit, then we either park, sniff, or hold. And these three are basically different levels of sleep. Whether you want to go for a long sleep or a short sleep. And we will talk about this in more detail next time. Maybe we can, as long as we have some time here. Yeah, so standby is initial state. Inquiry is the master sends an inquiry packet. It lays to scan for the inquiries and respond with their address and track after random delay. So this is where basically, it is contention. Is that you say, yeah, does anybody want to join me? So when I turn on my phone and I have Bluetooth on, actually I don't have my Bluetooth on. If you have Bluetooth on, then it will be advertising. Say that I am available and this is my network ID. Does anybody want to join me? That is the inquiry. Page, master in the page state invites device to join the PicoNet, and that is basically, it is sent in three consecutive slots, three different frequencies. Slave enters the page response state and sends page response during its device access code. So whenever somebody gets, so basically what it is saying is that you say somebody wants to join, it will do in three consecutive slots, and that way it will be in three different frequencies. We don't have to be consecutive, three different frequencies. The slots are consecutive in time. And so a slave, when they hear that, and it might take quite a bit of time for this to hear, because slaves are also scanning. Okay, do I hear anything on this channel, on this channel, on this channel, on this channel, right? But if they hear, then they can say, yes, I want to talk. So it lays in the response state and sends the response request. And it says, device access code, it says, this is my number. Master informs the slave about his clock and address so that the slave can participate in the PicoNet, and the slave computes the clock offset. So basically, any response that comes back from the master, it says, look, my clock is right now at 300 and so much at this moment, and that your number is 2. So that is what it means. It tells about the clock and the address. And then the slave knows how much different its clock is from the master's clock, so that it can run on the master's clock. And then it gets into connected state to receive the address, and then it can do the transmit. The inactive states, there are three. I will do this next time. As I said, there are three levels of sleep. Park means you are in deep sleep. Sniff means you are taking slight nap. right on the desk. You know, you can wake up much faster. And so we'll do that next time.